definition of pop.
Pop is an explosion.
You can sing along to it right away.
Makes you want to stand up, makes you happy, and it's fun.
I actually think everything's pop.
It's got flavors of rock.
Brainwashing hooks.
It's very high energy.
It's got flavors of hip-hop.
If it's got a na-na-na or a sha-la-la.
Pop is my daddy.
I think love is 90% of the music.
Love gone bad, love gone good, love indifferent.
One year it was Britney, the next year it was Puffy. It
starts with NSYNC and ends with Britney.
Nobody wants to be pop, but everybody is pop.
Catch tune. Some good words and a lot of attitude.
Backstreet, Britney, NSYNC, Christine, everybody talk about pop music. Talk about pop music. Talk about pop music. Talk about pop music.
I gotta have it.
Talk about funky, man.
Earliest memories of MTV.
When MTV only had like 4 videos.
Watching the moon man walk across the moon.
Everybody was on this whole I want my MTV thing.
I want my MTV!
We didn't have cable.
We kind of grew up with MTV.
I got grounded for watching MTV. My mom said it was nasty. And now I'm on it.
Hi, I'm John Norris, and welcome to a celebration of 20 years of pop music on MTV. Over the past 2 decades, pop has meant many things and pop music has taken many forms. Is pop a sound or is pop a feeling, an attitude, an audience, a place in culture? Well, today, the music we think of as pop on MTV borrows from rock, R&B, funk, hip-hop, and world beats. And as the sound of pop has become more diverse, so have the artists. It's been 20 years since the August 1st, 1981 launch of MTV. And although pop music, of course, existed before the channel was around, it clearly has not been the same since.
MTV had a massive part of changing pop.
I think pop music as it stands today couldn't exist without MTV.
It has changed the face of pop culture and pop music completely.
It's tearing up my heart when I'm with you.
Today, music videos aren't the only MTV pop stars use for exposure. With everything from the VMAs to TRL to Cribs, MTV is host to an ever-increasing number of opportunities for artists to reach millions of viewers every day.
MTV has come up with so many cool shows. I think it's made a lot of the artists real.
Oh, he's so gorgeous, I want to eat you up. I love you so much.
Oh, it was very important to sort of be on TV of any kind, particularly on music TV.
24 hours a day on cable TV.
It's all part of getting people to see what you were like.
MTV is so worldwide. I mean, you go to Japan and it's like MTV. You go to London, it's MTV. MTV is everywhere, and to get that type of exposure, only MTV can do it.
Although today's pop has its critics, the genre has come a long way since it first hit MTV 20 years ago. In the early 80s, when MTV was still virtually uncharted territory, many bands were producing straightforward, sometimes uninspired, performance clips. But a handful of pop artists with an eye for the visual saw MTV as a golden opportunity to break through with a new approach to the music video medium.
Smell like a sound, I'm lost in a crowd, and I'm hungry like the world.
When it came to video, it was very new then, and for us, it was such an incredible medium to experiment with, and we said, okay, let's make a little mini movie. Let's give it a little bit of a storyline. Let's make something that fits with the vibe of the song.
I love Duran Duran, and they had great videos. I remember Rio, the one with it all on the yacht.
It was just funny, they're rowing this boat, but they're like,
Rio, and
her name is Rio, and she dances on the sand.
They were dead serious about these setups, you know? It's like, it's just funny.
They were sort of telling people in suburbia that they could be wealthy and they could go out with supermodels and they could be successful. They were sort of selling this very glamorous image of champagne and yachts and exotic locations. And we were sort of telling people that they could be queer.
Another another British pop star born out of the London club scene, Boy George, along with his band Culture Club, was using the new medium to unleash his unique look and engaging personality on the world, and in the process to make an implicit statement about being yourself.
Videos were like a kind of postcard that you sent around the world. I wanted to be that type of artist that was visually stimulating, was expressing something about how I saw the world.
I did not know he was saying karma, karma. In my neighborhood, it was come a chameleon.
I remember it being a topic of conversation, like at school or whatever. Is that a man or a woman?
And I dressed up since I was like 13. I'd been walking around like that for 10 years. Except that now I was in a band, and so it gave me an excuse to look ridiculous.
It's just the look. I mean, it's... Beautiful, baby.
I think one of the most important things about MTV, if you were like a kid living in, you know, sort of somewhere in the Midwest who was gay, who felt like an alien, suddenly, you know, you saw people like Boy George or Cyndi Lauper or Madonna. It was like, wow, I'm not alone. So I think in that respect, it was very important.
My earliest memory of pop on MTV was Cyndi Lauper singing, Girls Just Wanna Have Fun.
Cyndi Lauper, she was so quirky and crazy.
Who is this girl, Cyndi Lauper, and why is she so unusual?
Like Boy George, the U.S. had its own pop star who appreciated outrageous styles, the makeup brush, and self-expression. Cyndi Lauper created videos that fiercely defended her own radical look, all in the name of individuality.
And as soon as I saw Cyndi Lauper, I was like, that's my girl. She totally inspired me. I was like, she rocks.
I was kind of shocked that I could do something that actually would have an effect on people. But this medium, this MTV, was a large part.
She was a real feminist in the best sense of the word. I mean, she's one of the first to really make that kind of statement.
She was another female that was out there doing crazy things, not afraid to dress however she wanted to and get out on the streets.
It's great to establish who you are and what you are and what you're saying and what you want to look like, because individualism is really important.
Props to females who've done it before us, you know, kind of opened the door for us that wanted to follow and do our own thing as well.
Coming up, New Kids Mania takes over the channel.
I was a fan. I thought their stage show was awesome.
But first, 80s superstars break down walls of race, sexuality, and gender.
I like anybody that's not afraid. And that's why I really liked Madonna, because she loved to take heat. I would go like this to if I saw her right now.
And the megastar who walked away.
I think George Michael decided very much he wanted to distance himself from his early pop stuff.
Pop music, talk about.
Aquí celebrando los 20 años de MTV hoy aquí en el canal, así que les quería contar que en 3 horas habrá un concierto en vivo desde Nueva York. No se pueden perder eso, porque van a estar tocando Aerosmith, se va a estar presentando en vivo Bon Jovi, Sugar Ray, Depeche Mode, excelente, Blink-182, Billy Idol. Billy Idol, va a estar también Jane's Addiction, Fred Durst, TLC y, bueno, todos los artistas que van a estar también contando la historia del rock en 1 hora aquí en Testimonios del Rock. Pero primero vamos a Historia del Pop.
She's a triple threat. She's got good music, she's sexy, she can dance.
Blending schoolgirl innocence, glamour girl sex appeal, and sing-along hooks, Britney Spears is well on her way to becoming the TRL generation's first real superstar. While her Mouseketeer Gone Bad performance at the 2000 VMAs did raise some eyebrows, to others, Britney seems well poised to join the ranks of MTV's more seasoned icons.
Ooh, I did it again.
She's affected many girls in the teens today that eventually will become the Madonnas of the future.
When I was younger and I'd watch Madonna and Michael, they're just like, you know, performing and putting their heart out there. And that's what I hope to do.
By the mid-80s, MTV had established itself as the place where music's trends were set, its rules were broken, and its biggest stars were born. While earlier acts had elevated the music video to an art form, a select few of the decade's performers changed the channel and pop, and in fact society forever, by breaking down walls of gender, race, and sexuality. Standard setter, sexual iconoclast, and pop provocateur, Madonna has survived almost two decades of shifting trends on MTV by staying at least one step ahead of the pack, continually reinventing herself in the process.
Erotic. Erotic, erotic. You gave me fever.
Some people are just cool. Everybody wants to be like Madonna because she's just cool.
She is constantly changing, constantly trendsetting. That's what keeps people interested.
Madonna unveiled her unique brand of button pushing at the Virgin VMAs in 1984. Her not-so-blushing bride got pulses racing as the MTV audience was exposed to the first of Madonna's unforgettable string of groundbreaking performances on the channel.
That is a classic. That was great. I think that shocked a lot of people, and it was a great, you know, introduction to the world for Madonna.
She made every teenager kind of horny. She made me horny.
What are you looking at?
But like almost everything she's done, Madonna's notoriously charged videos and live appearances over the last 20 years were not just about shocking. In fact, they've served a larger purpose. Many of today's young stars who grew up watching her on MTV have been empowered by Madonna's message of sexual freedom on her own terms.
Madonna definitely opened the door for a lot of other female artists to get out there and not be afraid. I mean, as her song says, to express yourself and to be bold and to be courageous, when hopefully I'll be able to follow in her footsteps as well. She just has a lot of confidence and she believes in herself, and I admire that, you know. I think that's beautiful, and I think that comes across in everything that she does.
The idea isn't that I have to top myself, but that I have to expand my own horizons and tackle the next issue or go further in terms of creativity and what it is I want to say.
We learned from her the more controversial you can be, the more popular you can be.
So yeah, because we're the most albums.
So watch us on tour. We have G-string.
Yeah.
No.
Whoa.
That's not controversy. That's just
that's
sick.
That's a thriller in itself.
A superstar since childhood, Michael Jackson revolutionized the music video and MTV in 1983, when the mini-movie Thriller took the channel and MTV's audience by storm.
I remember being a little kid watching Thriller. It scared me so bad, but I love that video.
I remember the first time I saw that video, I was like, oh my gosh, it was crazy. You know, it was the first time a video was like a movie.
But even more remarkable, given the diversity of today's MTV lineup, was the fact that Michael Jackson was the first major African-American presence on the channel, which in its first few years was largely the domain of white rock bands.
I do remember the hassle of introducing black artists to MTV because, let's face it, was solely for white artists at that point. But again, you know, you have to be outstanding to break down the walls. And Michael and others are outstanding.
Said something for being.
student of those that came before him. In the late 80s, George Michael strove to reach the superstar plateau and made the MTV audience take a new look and listen to a pop star that they had known for years.
Wake me up before you go, go. Don't leave me hanging on like a yo-yo. Wake me up before you go, go.
I love George Michael. I really fancied him. You know, I mean, the videos in the 80s, when we look back now, they're so tacky, but they were so great for the time.
Baby, I'm yours.
The pop music of England's Wham may have been infectious, but it in no way prepared people for what Michael had in him as a singer and songwriter. In 1986, only 2 years after their MTV breakthrough, the two-man band parted ways. And just 1 year later, a more mature George Michael was back in the new roles of international solo star and sex symbol.
Yes, I gotta have faith. Ooh, I gotta have faith. Because I gotta have faith, faith, faith. I gotta have faith, faith, faith.
I used to like George Michael when Faith came out. Not that that's funny in any way. I'm only laughing because I kind of had a crush on George Michael, and I think you understand why I'm laughing.
I will be your bodyguard, put your tiny hand in my baby. I will be your preacher, teaching anything you had to try.
By the decade's end, George Michael's undeniable talent and blatant sex appeal had elevated him on the charts and the channel to the status of other superstars of the time.
Ladies and gentlemen, the diva himself, George Michael!
But just as quickly as George Michael had achieved megastardom, he appeared to turn his back on it. In what seemed like moments after earning near icon stature, George Michael was absent from his second solo album's only hit video, in which the symbols of his pop fame were symbolically destroyed.
When I went for that bracket, there was Madonna and Prince and Jackson. Having succeeded to a large extent, I realized that I ended up in the wrong room with the wrong people.
I think George Michael decided very much he wanted to distance himself from his early pop stuff.
Oh, yeah.
At the expense of commercial success in America, maybe not so much so in Europe.
Later on, Destiny's Child strikes an independent pose.
I honestly believe that Destiny's Child went from the next in vogue to the new Supremes.
But next up, Club MTV brings dance floor divas into homes across the country.
It was a place to go, sit down after school, and watch. Say, I want to be that. That can be me. It's a place to dream.
And scandals and changing tastes and pop stars packing.
It got all got rainy and stuff, and everyone moved to Seattle and started making records.
Talk about, talk about, hey, talk about.
Aumenta su precio en la tierra. Equipos de protección biológica luchan por salvar árboles clorofílicos ante el fracaso de la implantación de árboles virtuales. Desde Saturno, Selene Androide, enviada espacial.
I like NSYNC. They're very talented. And looks like they're just having fun.
You can't even really say anything about their stage show. It's just tight every time.
They had the TV monitors where they were able to brilliantly get behind them, and it was seamless with choreography.
With innovative videos, cutting-edge choreography, and the requisite good looks, NSYNC have all the elements of a superstar boy band. And even though it may be a cliche, NSYNC say keeping it real has also been a key to their mega success.
You don't have to be controversial. You don't have to be something that you're not to be successful. We just did our thing, and eventually it finally showed up.
While NSYNC, along with Backstreet, Britney, Christina, Destiny's Child, and more, spearheaded the late 90s return of teen pop to MTV, some right here on what is usually the TRL set,
It certainly was not the first time that a young act's presence was felt on the channel. A decade earlier, another teen pop uprising took MTV and the music world by storm. And this one was led by the global phenomenon of Five Guys out of Boston.
I was a fanatic of New Kids. I was like seven. I remember I was wearing the pajamas and stuff.
I think I racked up like a $118 phone bill for their hotline. I made them rich. I got in so much trouble. My mom still hasn't forgiven me.
It'd been a while, you know, since the Osmonds and the Jacksons. Sometimes things just explode.
New Kids were, of course, not the first boy band to become pop stars. In fact, their formula seems strangely familiar.
Ronnie, Bobby, Ricky, and Mike. If I love the girl, who cares who you like?
After New Edition achieved their first measure of pop stardom, their enterprising producer, the General Maurice Starr, set his sights on something even more lucrative and figured correctly that there were even more millions to be made if he replicated the success with Five White Boys.
MTV had finally had a group that, you know, were singing black, sounded black, and it was a carbon copy of New Edition.
It's like, hello, no, they're doing the same thing that New Edition did, but they getting all the success and all the fame and the glory from it, and it's just, it's so unfair.
Yeah, we're gonna send this one out to all those non-believers out there.
When the anti-pop backlash of the grunge era hit, it hit hard, and New Kids were the most convenient target. Even today, while it's clear that the current boy bands owe something to the NKOTB, just how much is a matter of debate.
I don't think there'd be boy bands of today if it wasn't for us.
You sucker.
Their backlash made it 10 times harder for us to break and to get MTV to play our music.
A lot of people thought that we were manufactured. We were just who we were, but then our personalities were exploited. Jordan's like the suave lead singer. Donnie was like the tough guy. And nowadays, it's sort of like a blueprint, you know, for boy bands.
Two of the guys actually sang on the record. The rest of the guys just showed up. If New Kids was a vocal group, they could still be around today.
Teen dance pop frontliners Debbie Gibson and Tiffany, along with the New Kids, were the picture of 80s pop success. However, the MTV superstar who helped launch the decade's dance craze is still going strong today, some 15 years after she first stormed MTV with her very own Declaration of Independence.
Janet Jackson, Control is like one of the most classic albums, and also I think that she took videos to another level as a female.
For the young girls like myself at the time, I looked at her and was just like, now that's how I gotta do it.
Give me a beat!
You know, and I was like, that girl can dance.
She's one of the best live performers we have. People like to see that, and that's where I think videos came from, is because of such great live performances. You want to see that, you know, put to music.
I think myself, Britney Spears, Christina Aguilera, some of the girls that were definitely like influenced by her, are incorporating that into some of their videos and live performances.
Wubba wubba wubba, downtown Julie Brown here for another edition of Club MTV.
In 1987, MTV got in sync with the dance craze when it launched Club MTV, the Wubba Wubba show that provided a platform for young artists to strut their stuff and for viewers to shake their booties.
Shake your love, I'm just gonna shake your love. Shake your love, I'm just gonna shake your love.
I remember performing on Club MTV at the Palladium, and at the time that was really kind of like a new, fresh thing.
It was just another way, another medium of taking a genre of music and putting it in a club format.
Hey baby, I'm forever your
girl. And it's only fitting that a former choreographer became one of the biggest stars of the Club MTV era. Ex-LA Laker girl Paula Abdul had worked with performers like Janet Jackson,
but broke through in her own right in 1988 with an impressive string of MTV hits.
The most exciting, of course, for me was getting my first video on MTV, and that video was Straight Up.
And the winner is
Paula Abdul.
Paula Abdul.
Paula Abdul!
It was such a surreal experience winning all the awards. That year at the VMAs was wow.
The use of pre-recorded vocals to enhance live performances has always been a common yet controversial pop practice. But in 1990, the issue exploded when it came to light that many producer-driven dance pop acts, like CNC Music Factory and Technotronic, were not only lip-syncing their material, but also keeping the often less photogenic real vocalists in the dark.
Martha Wash was the singer on that record, and when we saw the video, we saw a very, you know, cute little dark-skinned child singing the song, which we knew it wasn't her. You made a hit song off of this woman's voice. How come we can't see her? Shame, shame, shame. Shame on you.
Yeah!
Girl, you know it's true.
Along with the highly publicized rise and fall of Milli Vanilli, lip-sync scandals took their toll on pop music, damaging its credibility and only adding to a growing backlash.
Oh, honey, I felt it.
In the early 90s, the proverbial pendulum swung against pop with a vengeance.
I do think that maybe people lumped all pop acts together and assumed that none of them sang. And yeah, I think people did tire of that.
We definitely went through a period where it got rainy and stuff, and everyone moved to Seattle and started making records.
Coming up, R&B heavy hitters keep pop alive on MTV.
Who sings a pop song better than my wife?
And hip hop makes its way into the mainstream.
You listen to even like Britney Spears and Christina Aguilera and NSYNC, straight up hip hop.
New Kids, Puffy, Spice Girls, Ricky, everybody talk about pop music. Talk about pop music. Funky man.
Ahora.
Come on over.
From her hair to her clothes, Christina Aguilera is definitely not shy about exploring the flash and fun that success has to offer. But at the end of the day, this is one pop star that hopes she's remembered for her music.
All I wanna do, come over here, baby.
Christina Aguilera is doing her thing. That girl can sing.
You know, it's like a lot of these videos, they think, oh, it's just about color and choreography and vividness. I would just love it to be more about the music and a reflection of what that song is about.
We are back. You know, cyclical is the word so often used to describe the music business and the music on MTV. And if that's true, in the early 90s, pop music was definitely in a down cycle. The lip-sync scandals of groups like Milli Vanilli and the apparent artificiality of teeny bop acts made pop, for many people, a dirty word. The pendulum had swung, and MTV along with it, in favor of something more real and less calculated. Or at least being marketed as such, gangster rap and grunge.
I think people definitely rebelled against anything pop sometime after 1990, yeah. They wanted their grunge bands. They wanted people who cared nothing about image, you know, like just the anti-pop star. Pop stars were born.
While pop's presence on the channel was fading, it didn't disappear completely. There were still some stars who continued to shine, the ones who were the real deal.
We were not going to put up with fake singing. Americans were just not going to put up with that, and that was the bottom line. This is called music, it's called singing, it's called entertainment, then let's do that.
'85 was the year that a girl from New Jersey with music in her jeans made her grand entrance into the world of MTV. Drop-dead looks, catchy pop material, and one of the most powerful voices of a generation were the combination that made Whitney Houston into an instant star.
I want to dance with somebody.
She was the first person that I've seen on TV. She had a red dress on and she was singing. I said, Mom, I want to be like Whitney Houston. What little girl didn't?
She really was the one that
inspired me to take voice lessons because I was like, I want to sing like that.
Despite the largely anti-pop climate of the early 90s, Whitney achieved her greatest success with The Bodyguard and redefined herself as pop's elegant leading lady.
I remember the first time I saw her video for I Will Always Love You from The Bodyguard. It's just breathtaking.
We just appreciated the fact that she was singing a song that really meant something.
All girls who aspire to sing were definitely influenced by Whitney Houston, and that's something that nobody can deny.
Tearing the charts up, this is
Mariah Carey.
The other great female pop vocalist in MTV's 20 years is Mariah Carey, the singer and songwriter who began her ascent to superstardom singing ballads during the days of the dance divas. By the time she made her first live performance on the channel, it was obvious that Mariah's voice was a rare gift.
I was doing something different than what was popular. I didn't want to be in that kind of category because that's not who I am. I just wanted to be heard and people to hear my voice.
Mariah Carey was the person that made me want to sing. She was beautiful, she had great videos and great songs, and she could really sing.
Throughout the early 90s, Mariah produced one hit video after another, largely in the pop and R&B vein. But in 1995, as the hip-hop revolution was overtaking MTV, she incorporated the style into her own music. Her first collaboration with the Wu-Tang Clan's Old Dirty Bastard not only marked a change in Mariah's musical direction, but was also a milestone in the marriage of hip-hop and pop.
Me and Mariah go back like babies were pacifiers.
That's someone that grew up in New York, you couldn't help but be influenced by hip-hop. A lot of people never really saw the video where ODB tied the clown up, and that was one of the classic moments of my life. One of my favorite songs I've ever done, if not my favorite.
Because Mariah Carey and a hip artist are doing something together, all of a sudden someone's eyes are now open to something that they were really not used to listening to or seeing, but it's because of Mariah Carey. Hip hop and pop. She called it hip hop. If I need it
in
the morning or the middle of the
night. In 1992, Atlanta trio TLC hit MTV with an in-your-face safe sex message and another unique blending of the genres, making them stand out among the other groups of the time.
I can't say no girl group was out because Salt and Pepper was out, you know what I mean? But they were rap, you know, so it's like you have TLC, you know, we looked different, the sound was different, and we were saying stuff that nobody was saying.
But TLC's strongest message and greatest success was yet to come. In 1995, the ladies reached new heights with the musical morality tale, Waterfalls.
Don't go chasing waterfalls. Please stick to the rivers and the lakes that you're used to.
When Waterfalls came out, it changed TLC. To me, that was our mark from being just an artist to, I don't want to say superstar, but you know, it put us in that category. It separated us.
R&B is such an integral part of pop today, it's hard to imagine the genre without it. While hip-hop has left an indelible imprint on today's pop stars, on their music, their dance, and their fashion.
Hip-hop is a culture. It has crossed the color boundaries like rock and roll.
You listen to even like Britney Spears and Christina Aguilera and NSYNC, straight up hip hop.
Up next, TRL and the teen pop explosion.
Every time we would come, it would just get bigger and bigger, and now it's just like insane. They have to close down the streets whenever an act goes there to perform.
It's pandemonium out there. I got elbow in the eye.
And boy bands reject being labeled.
I think when they see something as well marketed as this, they automatically think that it's fake.
Pop music, talk about. Pop music, talk about. Pop music, talk about.
I'm a survivor. Yeah, yeah.
I'm a survivor, I'm a survivor.
Even though they're not that old, they're very like, you know, they've made it and they've been through a lot, and everybody's been, like, the whole world has been through it with them.
In only a few short years, Destiny's Child have experienced more ups and downs than many groups see in their lifetime, most notably their rotating roster. But 2001 was clearly their year, as these soul survivors topped the chart and took over MTV.
MTV has been such a huge part of Destiny's Child's success.
Totally. We are very grateful because we work so hard and it just means so much.
The whole, you know, independent woman thing, even with all the controversy that's going on around them, I take my hat off to them.
Welcome back to MTV's 20th anniversary celebration of all things pop. TLC's Chili is not the only one who appreciates the message coming from the independent women of Destiny's Child. But of course, the notion of strong women is nothing new. In fact, the slogan Girl Power was heavily promoted 4 years before Destiny's breakthrough by five irrepressible young ladies from England. Who at the time could have guessed that what seemed to be a flash in the musical pan would actually herald the return of pure, unadulterated pop?
Hi, we're the Spice Girls!
If you wanna be my lover, you gotta get with my friends. Make it last forever, friendship never ends.
I think what happened was when the Spice Girls came, there was no one out there like them, and they were the first girl group, I think, that people can go, wow, they're individuals.
Go on, go on! Go on.
Girl power.
Yeah!
I just kept thinking, surely they could have found five girls who can sing.
Regardless of their singing ability, it was like each and every one of them had a specific image. It was almost like a living cartoon.
To finally be, you know, getting sworn for pop music.
That was one of the most memorable moments, actually, of that era with the Spice Girls.
Pop music's rebirth was also helped along by the barely post-pubescent Tulsa trio, Hanson.
Like, wow, they sound young. It's either a little girl or kind of sounds like young guys. I saw the video, it was three cute young guys playing their own instruments.
Yeah.
And that was amazing to me.
The 1-2 punch of Hanson and the Spice Girls made MTV safe for pop music once again. And it wasn't long before the return to the charts of the ultimate teeny bopper act, one that follows a time-tested formula, the boy band.
Five young guys, they look good, they can dance, they can sing.
It's simple. You know, it doesn't really take a rocket scientist to figure out why these boy bands are so large.
Boy band is put together by a record company, you know, told what to do, they lip sync, and that's everything opposite of what we are. That's why we're kind of like cringe every time we hear it.
Sick of you little girl and boy groups, all you do is annoy me, so I have been sitting here to destroy you.
Boy bands, or male vocal groups as many of them prefer to be called, have been and probably always will be the single greatest target of those who oppose the sometimes prefab nature of pop. And those enemies of artifice were given even more ammunition when they saw a boy band come together before their very eyes on the MTV-produced show, Making the Band.
When they see something as well-marketed as this, they automatically think that it's fake. People today, I mean, they watch they watch the show Making the Band. They're like, oh, is that how y'all did it? And they're like, no.
It's the same thing as Survivor, and, you know, someone's got to get voted off, and it's big business now. But at the end of the day, it all comes down to the music. And if it's good music, it'll stick around. If it's not, then it'll fall by the wayside.
The late 90s pop explosion happily coincided with the opening of MTV's Times Square studio, offering pedestrians a pop culture peep show. The hit show Total Request Live meant throngs of fans now had daily access to the reigning pop princes and teen queens.
Your video is like big time right now on TRL.
Yeah, I saw it on MTV like 3 days ago. It was really cool.
I just hauled all my friends up, you know. Did you see it?
did you see it? Did you see it? You know, it was so silly, but that was a really cool moment.
We were up in the studio with Carson, and we were talking about the record and launching Millennium.
The New York Police Department's not allowing us to go to the windows and wave at everybody because they're afraid somebody's going to get hurt.
I was like, man, I can't believe it.
If you want to be with me, baby, there's a price to pay. I'm a genie in a bottle. You got to rub me the right way.
TRL has been very good to me. It is an important show if you want to be a mainstream pop artist.
As MTV has grown and changed over the years, so has the pop scene. Since its inception in 1981, MTV has evolved with pop. Both are now more diverse than ever. Pop has become the one genre where all genres meet.
I think MTV has dictated what is pop. They take chances on different artists, and the next thing you know, they're pop.
MTV can't take all the credit for the staggering success of today's teen pop. These days, the genre's audience and the marketing muscle behind it are bigger and stronger than ever. The in-your-face force of pop's recent renaissance has brought on the familiar critiques of pop pundits everywhere. Too safe, too manufactured, downright bland. And once again, critics and artists alike are predicting pop's demise.
What's the deal with this pop life, and when is it gonna fade out?
I think we've kind of had our fill of this whole, you know, pop thing.
It's almost become like a weird, interactive, psychotic festival of anybody can be a star.
Your dream.
Real W. Samantha Mumba.
This whole, you know, pop thing is real faddish to me. You see this group here, you see that group. Okay, well, what's the difference between the two? Nothing stands out. It's just like, man, when is this going to be over?
People consider it to be cookie cutter and very predictable. There has to be just this certain style of choreography, this certain style of clothes. The video has to be shot this certain way.
Pop has become associated with manipulating the public. Bands that are created for the sole purpose of shifting t-shirts, school bags, and things like that. I think pop has become a dirty word.
From big toy breakthroughs to boy bands gone bust, from Thriller to thongs, from unusual girls to independent women, over the past 20 years, pop on MTV has covered every ground imaginable. And although some are once again predicting another pop demise, this music has proven itself pretty resilient at bouncing back from such a backlash. So what's next for pop music?
I think pop music definitely is gonna go to another level.
Then you got to realize what we're doing is not a trend.
As long as there's kids and teenagers, there's always going to be pop. There's always going to be boy bands and girl bands. It might die off, and then it'll come back again. It will definitely come back again.
Happy birthday, dear MTV.
Happy 20th anniversary, MTV.
Yay!
You're not as old as I am, but I look better.
Feliz 20 años, MTV. Happy 20th.
Happy birthday. In one more year, you'll be old enough to drink.
Happy 20th birthday to you.
Happy mother birthday, MTV.
I'm so happy to be a part of the MTV family. Yeah, recognize, geek down.
Thank you, MTV, so much for all your support, and happy 20th anniversary.
MTV, happy birthday to you. Thank you for the years and the love and support.
Everybody talk about pop music.